which is in line here. Jeannie, what are we eating today?
Today we're eating Korean barbecue.
So Jeannie, what meat cut is this?
So this is 오겹살.
네, 감사합니다. Yay! So we're gonna get 된장, which is kind of like a fermented soybean soup, as SELF-ESTEEM. What does SELF-ESTEEM mean?
Free!
Free! Can you describe?
Yeah, so it's supposed to be 5 layers of fat, and apparently it's the butt area.
There's little compartments
oh, yeah.
here.
There's like kimchi, so there's like a boat of eggs, and we put cheese in it.
If you notice, there's this strange robot arm looking thing, and that's to keep the smoke alarm from going off. So we are actually going to drink flavored soju, which is very popular with the ladies.
I'm sure.
Something. Mm-hmm. Grapefruit flavored soju.
And look at this.
Oh, they're heart shaped.
Yeah.
I wonder if it's because we're girls.
Maybe.
Probably.
And it's 4 p.m.
Yeah.
It's been a while since I drank when the sun was out.
Oh, really?
Well, yeah, and in Korea, people, like, don't pour for themselves.
I mean, we could, because we know each other, we're not.
Yeah.
But, you know. Yeah. Since we have fancy shot glasses, we're going to have fancy manners. So yesterday, I went to Oheshik. And Oheshik is sort of like a company-mandated social event. And the company pays for everything, and it's usually some sort of Korean barbecue, like what we're having right now. And drinks. And so I did that yesterday, and I'm eating gogi, meat again today, but I think eating barbecue every day is not a problem for me. What about you?
The thing here, I didn't have plastic, but I also ate meat yesterday. Mm-hmm. Samgyeopsal. But today is 오겹살. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could eat meat every day. Mm-hmm. Wow, my hands are shaky. Is it because of alcohol? But yeah, there's like this skin part. And it makes it very chewy.
Cheers.
Cheers. Tastes like juice.
So, Korean barbecue, it also comes with, oh.
We got 된장찌개.
The fermented soybean soup. And they also have this onion and soy sauce thing. Really good. I don't care if my breath is kicking afterwards. I have no one to kiss. It's okay. Jeannie, we eat a lot.
We do. And we often complain about the side effects of eating too much.
Mm-hmm. I definitely gained about 20 pounds since I've come to Korea.
Yeah?
About 20 pounds.
I think I've lost a little bit, like not a lot, but just a little bit of weight since I came to Korea. Maybe the social pressures.
Ah. So this, now we've moved on to...
B. This is 갈비살. So ribs, like beef ribs. Dip the meat in samda, which is... What is samda?
It's like,
garlic.
I think it's also soybean.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if you can hear it, but hey, this is the buttocks. The wires are cartilage.
Are we talking about the ogyeopsa or mm-hmm. this thing?
Ogyeopsa.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Aren't you hot? You can't feel the AC?
We're outside, but the AC is pointing outside.
Korea is not the most environmentally friendly country in the world.
So, this is the egg.
Jeannie, in America, were you considered normal size, chubby?
I think I was still considered chubby.
By whom?
My mom.
How about by society in general?
I think by society in general. I mean, I was like, I still think I was on the heavier, like, not like big, but above average. Like, bigger than average, I think.
Okay, I think the best way to tell how society kind of sees you, like, honestly, is if kids, when you're kids and other kids make fun of your weight, you know, because kids are sometimes a little bit too honest. So when you were younger, did any kids ever, when they were trying to make fun of you or try to be mean to you, did they ever mention your weight?
When I was a little kid, yes. I was a really fat kid. I was really fat.
That's really cute.
Yeah, up until like maybe high school, it didn't go away. So, we do this. Put a little bit of samjang. And a clove of garlic, or half a clove, because we're not going to kiss anyone. And
who knows, maybe we'll get so drunk we'll kiss each other. It could happen.
It could. And then, omelette. 감사합니다.
My weight except my family, but that's because I think Koreans have a different idea of what being slender means. Like in America, I was always average weight. Like my weight was so unremarkable, nobody ever mentioned it unless they were Korean. I would get strangers, like strange Korean people who I don't know coming up and telling me things like, oh, all you need to do is lose a little bit of weight and you'd be so much prettier.
Yeah.
I'd be like, thank you for destroying my self-esteem. Thank you.
I get that, like, even just among Korean, like, friends. I mean, it's not like, I think in the Korean culture, it's not seen as something that's offensive. I think people just say it as a comment. Like, oh, I like your lipstick. Oh, if you lost a little weight, you'd be prettier. Or like, oh, you lost weight, or you gained weight. I think those comments are very common among Korean groups.
If you're talking about the generation that's like 55 and older, they will talk about your weight in front of your face. You could be walking down the street and they'll just be like, whatever, you know, like, this girl's legs are like this, like, her chest is like that. Like, they'll just dissect you like an object. And not just men, women will also talk about you. But I feel like younger Koreans don't do that as much.
Yeah, younger Koreans, but I think even among younger Korean friends, I think they always talk about weight, like, openly.
Yeah, and a lot of times I feel like it's a very self-loathing sort of open talk. Like, they're not saying, like, to each other, no, you're beautiful the way that you are, you don't need to lose weight. They don't say that to each other. Right? If a girl says, oh, I'm too fat, I need to lose weight, her friends always say, oh my god, that's a great idea.
Let's go on a diet together.
I was just commenting to Jeannie how I think it's fucked up how the way for Korean girls to bond is to go on a diet together. And when Korean girls diet, this isn't like counting your macros and eating like healthy foods, it's starvation. A diet in Korea is basically you're becoming anorexic. My mom, she would put me on a diet. Like she put me on a cottage cheese saltine cracker diet. She actually put up the diet plan on the refrigerator and I was supposed to follow it for, this was not like a regular diet, this was a crash diet, okay? And I'm like 12 or 13. I don't know how that fucked up my growth trajectory or anything like that.
Yeah, my mom put me on crash diets too. It was like, I remember this like grape diet. Like that first day you only eat grapes and you eat like 10 grapes in the morning, like 10 grapes for lunch and then like, I don't know, 10 grapes for dinner. Like 30 grapes a day. And then like after like that day or after 2 days, you can eat as many grapes as you want, but you don't want to put another grape in your mouth if all you've been eating for a couple of days was grapes.
Yeah.
I couldn't eat grapes for a long time.
Here's the thing, I think though my mom, she tried very hard to put me on diets. They never worked on me. Like I would maybe lose some weight, but I never lost a lot of it. It wasn't like, I think she envisioned me getting on this crash diet and then becoming like this like svelte supermodel, but at most maybe I'd lose like 10 pounds at most. It was never super dramatic or significant. Because that's what crash diets do. They, unless you starve yourself for like 6 months, your body's gonna go into metabolism shutdown mode.
I feel like you really only lose weight when you want to do it. Mm. Not when you're forced.
Mm-hmm.
우리 갈비살이를 한 번 더 주세요. 네.
갈비살이요? 네. We just ordered 옷살.
What's that?
I don't know. I've heard of 옷동심, and I think 옷동심 is, I might be wrong, but I think it's filet mignon.
Mm. Here we go, the filet mignon.
8 pieces.
Yay!
언제 가는 거야?
미국이요?
응.
좀 있을 것 같아요. So in your childhood, you were like a normal kid?
Normal size, but I always thought I was super chubby because my family thought I was chubby. It's very strange when society tells you that you're unremarkable, but your family thinks you're either positively remarkable or negatively remarkable. In a way, that saved me from deciding, oh, I'm definitely fat or I'm definitely thin. Because I was just like, how come they can't agree? You know, maybe I should just decide for myself. I would have to say, compared to most women, my body image is probably more on the positive side. How do you feel about your body?
I feel like I'm more... It's different every day. Some days I wake up, I'm like, I'm great, or I look great, and then some days I'll wake up and be like, oh my god. Yeah, it gets changed day to day. What about you?
For me, I don't think it's so much that it changes every day. For me, my angst usually comes from wondering what my life would be like if I were thinner. Like, maybe if I were, let's say, 20 pounds thinner, maybe my life would be completely different. Maybe my life would be so awesome and I don't even know. And that's what kind of causes me a lot of pain, because if I had that comparison, because I have never been thin in my life. It was never a point where I was like very thin and then I gained weight. So I don't know what it's like to be super thin. I just know that's what this country and my family says is great. And sometimes I'm just like, maybe they're right.
Yeah, because it's like, oh, if you're thin and if you're thinner and prettier, then like a richer guy will like want to marry you and then you'll have this like great life, etc.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is if you're thin, the type of man that you'll get will be better. Like if you upgrade yourself in terms of your thinness, then you'll upgrade your man. It's never like you'll be thin and then you'll be richer yourself because you'll get a promotion or whatever. It's more like, oh my god, if you're thin, you're gonna get a better guy. It's always related to getting a man.
Why is that?
I actually have a lot of fat. I think I mentioned in a previous video how the personal trainer was just like, you're 43% fat? Holy crap. So I'm like half fat, but I don't look it. I think I'm about, I haven't weighed myself in like a year, but I think I'm approximately 150 pounds and I'm about 5'2.5", 5'3". So actually Jeannie's a lot taller and she and I don't weigh that differently.
But we look different.
Different body types.
Oh, different body types. Yeah, it's different. I feel like I feel different about myself in Korea versus the States.
In what way?
In the States, I don't think I care as much. Yeah, if I'm bigger, whatever, I'll just buy a bigger size. But in Korea, if you're bigger, you can't find a bigger size.
You really can't.
What size?
And you dip it in oil and salt.
I feel like a size 10 or a 12 in Korea. Like, if you are a size 10 or 12 in America, you're like normalish. Like, I'm a size 10. In Korea, a size 10 is like, whoa. That'd be almost like considered like plus size in Korea.
And like, most stores, they're all like one, not most, but a lot of stores, I think the biggest size they have is kind of like medium.
And they call it large, or like, it's called one size.
It's small.
It's basically, I think, a size 6. I think a one size, the free size, I think it's a size 6. It's definitely not bigger than 6. In Korea, the guys that like me are guys who are above the age of 60 and guys who are under the age of 20. Both of them are not exactly my type. I mean, I appreciate it, but still. Did you ever have a boyfriend who made you feel really bad about your body? Really? In Korea or in America?
Korea.
Ugh, what happened?
It wasn't like really bad. While we were dating, it was like, oh, let's go on a diet.
Together.
Together. And because I think both of us, if we lost weight, we would look so much better. And like, that's like an underhanded way of telling me, hey, if you lost weight, I think you'll look better, so let's go on a diet. Yeah. And maybe say things like, oh, if, like you said, if you lost weight, you'd be prettier, like that. Well, that didn't end well, did it? What about you?
I had a boyfriend in America. Not a Korean boyfriend, but a white dude.
A white? I didn't know white guys. Finish your story.
This guy, he told me, you know, the reason why I started going out with you, and he was like my boyfriend of like 4 years. He told me, you know, when we first started dating, I thought that you would lose 10 pounds, and that's why I was like, I'm not totally attracted to her right now, but I will be once she loses 10 pounds. But instead I gained 15 pounds. He was trying to motivate me to lose weight because he just saw how much I ate. And while he was telling me this, you know, I'm stuffing my face. And as sort of a way to tell him to fuck off, I think I ate more than I wanted to. Just to spite him. Yeah. So I was just like, you're not the boss of me. That's what happens when you're young and you don't have the best self-confidence. You hear this guy who is supposed to love you tell you that, I kind of pity dated you, or I saw your potential. I saw your potential. I'm not into how you are right now. But
I think I could be later on.
Yeah. I think that even if I were 10 pounds thinner when I met him, he would have still thought of something else. If not my weight, it would have been some other thing where I don't like her exactly as she is right now, but she has potential. Yeah, I feel like when people criticize your looks, they're in a way just looking for something to nitpick. I have never in my life ever like thought to myself like, maybe I should tell a girl that she should go on a diet and that's gonna help her. I have never in my life ever thought that. Ever. it's very difficult not to internalize all the fat shaming that goes on in society. Even when I'm trying to be the most self-aware, if I gain, let's say, if I gain 5 pounds and I feel it on my body, like my pants don't feel right, there's definitely at least 10 seconds where I kind of panic. Like, ah, fuck, I'm getting fat. And the thing is, I would have to gain, I think, like 40 pounds to really get fat. And yet that 5 pound weight gain will put me into a panic until I tell myself, whoa, 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 don't exaggerate. But that's the instant reaction that I have. Ah, I'm getting fat. And if I get fat, then all these other, you know, like, scenarios will happen. I won't be as attractive, I won't be like this, I won't be like that, I won't be like that. Well, I've had a boyfriend who actually, he got really mad at me once, the same boyfriend who told me that he would like me better once I lost 10 pounds. He got really mad at me, and he actually, during an argument, he like poked me in my stomach, and he was just like, well, you know what, you're fucking fat. Look at all this fat on you. Yeah. Crazy thing is, I still stayed with him for another 6 months. Yeah, but during an argument, he like threw down like the major sort of like ad hominems, you know, like he was, instead of talking about like the argument we were having, which was about, I don't know, something else, he decided he was gonna go there. You're fat, look at all this fat, I can't stand it. I know. I think in a lot of ways,
was that emotionally scarring? Like, were you hurt for a while?
I think so. I think when the guy who's supposed to love you tells you that you're fat and disgusting, that's the type of emotional abuse. So, sad to say, but I was in an emotionally abusive relationship. He didn't smack me around physically, but definitely he told me in no uncertain terms that I just was not attractive. I could be. I think he thought it was okay to say that I wasn't attractive at the moment because it was always in the sort of sense that you could be. Oh my God, if you just did this, you've got potential, which makes me think, if we wouldn't accept a boyfriend telling us that we're too fat and they're supposed to love us, then what makes it okay for our families? We're supposed to love us even more. We're supposed to love us unconditionally. What makes it okay for them to be like, you're great, but you're just really fat? We're gonna order fatty pork.
I honestly think that the reason why our families tell us to lose weight is because, like you said, like your society tells us a certain message and it's hard not to internalize it. So I think they tell us that because they love us.
They think they're being loved.
Oh. Like, they're watching out for us or the way they think that they're doing it. Be like, to prevent future harm or to make life better for us.
It's kind of like, oh, you should study more so you get better grades, so you can get to a better school. Oh, you should lose some pounds so that you'll be more popular with guys and then you'll be more successful in life. They're saying it out of love. They have no clue that it's actually very emotionally down putting. Jeannie, are you good at cooking meat?
I am not.
I suck at cooking meat.
Maybe I'm better than you.
You're better than
I'll
me.
I'll try.
Yeah. So for me, I think that I started to gain weight when my parents divorced. So for me, food was my therapist. Like, food gave me that warm, secure feeling that no one else was giving me. I think the adults kind of felt as though, oh, they're kids, they wouldn't understand. Kids understand. They may not understand words, but they understand energy. And they understand when things are being kept from them. They understand when things aren't right. Kids are very intuitive like that. So if you don't communicate with children, then they don't know how to communicate with you. They're children. My mom and my dad, when they were divorcing, my mom went to America for a couple months and I was left in Korea with my grandparents for a couple months. She came back like 2-3 months later. And one of the first things that she said to me when she came back was, "You got so fat." And it's kind of funny now because I feel as though if I were me as an adult, as a grown woman, and if I could travel back in time, as soon as my mom back then would tell like 5-6 year old me, "Wow, you got super fat," adult me would be like, "Yeah, because for 2-3 months nobody's been telling her shit." That's why she got fat. This young child's life has been turned upside down. Her parents have divorced. And now you're taking away that one thing that gives her comfort. You're taking away food, which is the one thing that doesn't judge her, that keeps her warm and feeling safe and grounded. Like that, you know, that nice, warm, fuzzy feeling you get when you're super full? Yeah, it's like, who else is giving that child that feeling? So I think that when you punish a child for trying to soothe themselves, I think my mom saw it just purely as, oh, you know, it's because she eats too much. And not realizing the emotional component of eating too much. So when you punish somebody for trying to make themselves feel better, I think that's very damaging. It's kind of like when you punish drug addicts instead of trying to get them help. When you put them in jail instead of trying to get them rehabilitated, we don't treat drug addiction as emotional and mental health issue. We treat it as like a defect in their personality. And I think a lot of times people who see fatness as disgusting, they see food and the human body and fat on the human body as a moral issue in a way. Like if you're fat, there's something wrong with you. If you're fat, there's something deficient in you. They don't think, why did you gain all this weight that's not healthy for your brain?
Yeah. So, I think some people, it's not necessarily emotional, but they just like food. No, I don't think there was a reason for my, like, when I was a child, I was, feel like a picture. I was like, you know.
I've seen pictures.
Big. I was like pretty like.
Jeannie looks completely different from when she was in college.
Oh yeah, when I was in college. I think like, I think until like after college, I didn't really care what I looked like. Like up until, I just didn't care. Yeah, I don't know why.
It was a good thing.
Yeah, and like my, but I was like constantly reminded that I should care, but I didn't. So if you look at college photos.
Yeah. When you say, some people they just like food.
Uh-huh.
I think some people are just naturally more into, I guess the Greeks would have called them aesthetes. Like they're more into food, they're more into beautiful fabrics, colors, beautiful music, great wine. There's some people who just naturally like beautiful, comfortable things in life. And good food is one of those great things in life. So you just have a much more aesthetic personality.
I'm an aesthete.
Even right now, with all the messages that society is telling us about how even being slightly chubby is not as great, when I look at different types of bodies on the street, I don't naturally think, oh, I don't find that attractive or whatever. I honestly look at the lines of that body, and sometimes I see a very voluptuous woman, and I look at the lines of her body and the way she wears her clothes, and I find it very beautiful. I'm just like, almost in a way, when you look at a painting, and you're just like, wow, the lines of this are very beautiful. So like, I think that if I hadn't been taught fat is bad, skinny is good, I would have truly, I think, seen every single body type as being almost like equal but different. There's like a certain sort of body type that's like fat, but like, the roles, I know this is going to sound very interesting or a little bit strange, but the roles are kind of, they're very, like when you see statues of like zaftig women, especially modern statues or like statues either that are very modern or like from a long time ago, like those fertility statues, and the women are like very round and they got roles of fat. it looks very sensuous. It's almost like ocean food. And I look at them, and they're like in Columbus Circle in New York City, that mall. There's like these like statues of like these acting women, and they're just like portly, huge, like fat, solid, like women. And whenever I see them, I feel so happy because I think they're beautiful. I'm just like, oh,
yeah.
It makes me so happy to see those statues until like the judgment kicks in. But before the judgment kicks in, I look at them and I think they're beautiful. That just shows you maybe people are born naturally like not giving a shit. And it's just because a bunch of people in the fashion industry and the marketing industry decided, how do we make people feel shitty about themselves so that they'll buy our diet products and buy all these other things that'll make them feel better, because we're telling them they're not good enough.
Is that what you did at Paisik?
No. I have no manners at Paisik. Everybody was keeping my like beer glass full, and I was just like, thanks guys. I had this one boyfriend, a Korean-American boyfriend actually, and I was with him for 5 years. Five years, yeah. And he thought that me eating was like the cutest thing. It's just nice to have like an egg. So this boyfriend, he thought it was the cutest thing when I ate. He was just like, you look like a little rabbit when you eat. So he would encourage me. He was kind of like a feeder. He would encourage me to eat. He'd just be like, here, eat this. Here, eat that. And while I was eating, he'd kind of look at me like with like hearts in his eyes. Like,
aww.
I think he would be really nice to go out on a date with. He'd just be like, just buy this girl like drinks and like some food and like maybe like a couple of Snicker bars.
Mm-hmm.
And she'll be okay. What's your favorite food?
Favorite food? There's chocolate now.
Yes.
Chocolate. What about you?
My favorite food is definitely extra rare prime rib.
May I change my answer?
Yes, you may change.
I like medium rare filet mignon. Oh, maybe chocolate. I can't pick.
But
no choco pie for you.
Choco pie, not crazy about it. But I will eat the fuck out of some like taco truck tacos. Like for me, I think I also am very impressed by authenticity. So I'm one of those like crazy people. I'm afraid of heights. Like super afraid of heights. I will climb like Mount Everest and go across like shark infested waters to get to a little tea house in the middle of like nowhere that's like supposed to be the best tea house in the world, just so that I can have it, you know. After I will do that. So I will go and eat someplace where they'll be like, the hygiene here isn't that great, it's a woman squatting over a fire cooking stuff, you sure you want to eat it? And I'll be like, I read about it in a blog, it's supposed to be great, I will eat it, no problem.
Wow, yeah, I don't have that drive. I think like food is food. I wish I had that drive. I'm like, oh, like wait in line for like an hour to eat at this one place when I can get the same thing like somewhere else. Yeah. But you would wait in line.
Oh no, I would never wait in line.
But you swim across shark infested water.
Yes, because that adds to the experience. Waiting in line adds to no experience. If you already felt insecure about your looks, I don't think losing weight is going to help you feel better, because it truly is one of those things where, you know, like they always say, oh, you know, I lost a lot of weight, but I still feel like a fat girl inside. I really think that self-confidence is an inside job, because I know some people who are, they'd be considered fat by most everyone, right? But there's just something about them, they're so confident, they have so much swagger. Despite society judging them, they have so much swagger.
Where does that come from? Where do you think?
I don't know, but whatever drugs that they're taking, I want it. Have you seen that movie, that John Carpenter film about that? It was made in the 80s, what's it called? Oh, where it's like that dude, he puts on glasses and he sees the subliminal messages.
What movie is this?
It's called called? Like, they live, I forget. But it's like, there's that really famous line, like, I came here to chew gum and kick ass and I'm all out of gum or something like that. It's a very famous cult movie. And I feel like people who have a lot of swagger, despite not having a traditionally acceptable body, they are wearing those lassos. They see the subliminal messages that are being sent by fashion advertising, by whatever else. And they're just like, yeah, I see what's really going on. And I'm not buying into it because I know it's not. They see a certain sort of truth. They have a certain perspective. And how they get the perspective, I don't know. I would love that perspective. I think in a way though, like talking about it, it helps one become more aware of your current perspective, which helps you get toward, because maybe for some people it's not a switch that turns on where one day you just wake up and you're just like, I slay. Maybe it's a gradual thing for some people where it's like step by step, bit by bit, you just accept yourself and other people more and more. Everybody's journey is different.
And maybe like part of the reason why we think like, maybe the reason why we think like our lives will be happier when we're thinner is because we feel better about ourselves. I feel like good about myself and I'll just feel happier because I'm more content with myself.
That's probably, yeah, sometimes I think like I would get validation from others. Like sometimes I'll see how people talk glowingly about somebody who's a lot thinner and I'll be like, wow, it would be nice if somebody talked about me that way. So maybe getting that external validation would feel nice, but is it? But those things are fleeting, aren't they? Because it's sort of like, you know, like I was listening to this interview that Deborah Harry, who was the lead singer of Blondie, in her heyday she was considered one of the most beautiful women in the world, but then as she got older, you know, like there's that saying that once a woman hits like 40, 50, she becomes invisible. You know, and especially for like a beautiful woman, a woman who like almost all her life she was being chased after by men, admired by women, constantly getting the external validation from society. She hits a certain age, and then she's no longer beautiful. She's just an old woman. And what does that feel like? So external validation, it's fleeting, and I think that it doesn't feel as substantial as when you have your own validation. So it's kind of like, how can we get confident about the way that we look despite what society says or doesn't say?
How?
Leave us comments.
Oh, we should have pulled this up in the beginning. That's better.
Now, I don't know about you, but my eye always goes towards people who have interesting energy, interesting style. There's lots of pretty people, but there's when you meet somebody who's like stylish, they like make an impression on you. So to be perfectly objective, your body or even your face, it's not as important as your style. It's not as important as your energy.
What about personality?
Style is your personality worn on the outside.
Expression.
That's how I feel. We had 5 rounds of meat.
Oh man. I wasn't counting, but
I feel so healthy though.
Yeah, it's meat.
It's meat. Glaucoma is coming soon, I can tell, because my brain is shutting down. My tongue is slowing down. I think my bad breath went away though.
You had bad breath?
Because I eat onions.
Oh, I ate onions. Garlic and onions. I think my bad breath went away too.
Yay! So we could kiss somebody tonight.